entrepreneurs are essentially people who we define as individuals who have new ideas to solve problems at a systemic scale. So we identify them, we support them, and we use the network effect to see how they can scale their ideas rapidly and globally as well. So that's where Ashoka comes from. Just to give you an idea from where, I mean, why I've been invited to speak at an education meet, essentially, right? So Ashoka is not an education organization. We actually only recently started our work with schools, literally 6 months ago. So we're very new in this journey, and it's been an exciting process of discovery for all of us. But to give you an idea of where this comes from, right? We've had 30 years of experience working with social entrepreneurs who think at that level of systemic change. And when we were assessing who these guys were and what made them successful, we found out that the most successful social entrepreneurs are the ones who are engaging with different kinds of people, different kinds of communities, multiple communities, to get them to take their ideas forward, right? So they were very open about their ideas, they gave them up to the communities, and they built the capacity of different people to carry out those ideas wherever they go. And this is what, I mean, I guess one of the examples I like to use, it has its controversies, is Wikipedia, right? So Jimmy Wales is an Ashoka fellow, and what he did was he had an idea, but he just created a platform, and he allowed a whole bunch of people to come in, collaborate, contribute, take it, do whatever they wanted with it. Didn't put, I mean, put a whole bunch of due diligence around it, but still allowed, and I think what that did was it created this movement for openness, and that's probably why many of us are here today, because of one of the things that sparked off that movement, which was the early years of Wikipedia. Stop me if I'm wrong, this is just how I interpreted this whole thing, really. So just to take that forward, so you were like, you know, what do social entrepreneurs do and what makes them successful? They create change makers. And looking at the way the world is shifting so rapidly today, what we define as success for the world going forward is the need for more people to be change makers, right? And by change making, let's just quickly define it because it's such an ambiguous term, it's basically people who are looking for solutions where most people are looking for problems. So today in the morning, we just saw a whole bunch of discussion around what are the problems in the education system and what are the problems in data? And so many people were like, well, it's easy to point out the problems. What are people doing about it, right? That's when we come to this. So the people who are actually finding those solutions, actively trying them out, that's who we call change makers. And if you see, like, you know, if you want to create a world where everyone can be a change maker as a skill, then what do we have to do about it, right? That's when Ashoka went through a process of internal reflection saying, how, I mean, do we do this? Do we shift our vision? Do we evolve our vision? What do we want to do? And we decided, well, you know, we are in a position where we can accelerate demand for more people to become change makers. Therefore, we're going to jump into this. I'm really not good at this. You know, you're listening, me talking. So at any point, if you all have any things you'll want to say, just, you know, let me know. I know that the question answer session is a little bit later, but at any point, yeah. So so that's where, you know, we said let's do this. And we looked at change making and we said, what is the core of it? And we said, well, to become a change maker, first you have to be empathetic. And if you're looking at what empathy is, when you generally define empathy, we see it as a very emotional construct, right? Something that is inbuilt in us, and if you don't have it, but you know, the way we're trying to define this is we're shifting this a little bit, and we're saying emotional empathy is very important, but there is a whole aspect of cognitive empathy which we can teach children and we can teach people to learn, right? And this aspect of cognitive empathy is what's driving us right now. And what I mean by that is empathy, which allows us to understand how other people are feeling, how other people see the world, allows us to collaborate to solve problems, allows us to lead sometimes and take the backseat and allow other people to lead sometimes. And it allows us to listen to each other and articulate what we are thinking in a way that other people can understand, right? So this is essentially the core skills that we want the world to start, but people in the world to start, you know, developing, right? And that's when we ask, okay, if we have to develop these skills, where do we go? And we looked at ourselves and we said, you know, as, you know, people in the space, people who are trying to lead change, people who are trying to do all of these things, what shaped us? And that's when we looked at the education system. And, you know, a space where you can develop these skills and do it at a scale which is unprecedented. And so just to take a step back at this point, and you see, you look at the world the way it's moving, and you look at this education system where it is at right now, just a quick question to the audience. Do you think the education system is building those skills that require children to be successful in the world, in this current world, the way it is right now?
Not in government schools.
Okay.
But in most schools.
I'm seeing a lot of shaking heads. Anyone saying yes?
Higher education, indeed.
Okay.
Exposed to the right institutions, higher education is at a ease.
Sure. Right. So
schools are.
Of course, you'll say that, Naveen. And I'll tell you why Naveen is saying that. But which is interesting, right? So, I mean, most of us are saying no, but yet all of us are in the room. So somewhere something went right for us, right? So we have to ask ourselves, why is this that only in a few spaces these skills are being developed and then not everyone else has access to those opportunities?
What went right for you and anybody else in the room is not the education system. You only learned everything from environment and, you know, experience.
So very
important.
Yeah, that's a very important thing you're pointing out. So what we're saying is, children grow up in certain kinds of environments, right? It could be a school environment, it could be a home environment, it could be a neighborhood environment, whatever it might be. And what makes us develop these skills is the fact that we grew up in a certain kind of way, in a certain kind of environment that facilitated the development of these skills. It may be school, it may not be school. So, but if we want to do this in such a way that everyone can get access to that, then schools are the logical kind of spaces to look at. Because even if we are not where we should be in terms of enrollment, we're not where we should be in terms of reducing dropout rates and things like that, still a vast majority of children in the country go to school. So we're saying, okay, can we shift how education, what are the skills that education builds, what the goals of education are, and, you know, in that process, build a world where everyone sees their potential to and their capacity to lead some kind of positive action, wherever they may be, right? So that's kind of where we are. So let me come to the house of this, because I think I've given you a really like large perspective on why we're doing this and what we want to achieve. But the house of this are equally important. So just like someone pointed out, you know, there are a few educational institutions, they may be in higher ed, they may be in primary, elementary education, which are building these skills, but a vast majority of them are not. So what we are doing is we're trying to identify those institutions which are already building change makers. This could be at any level, it could be in any space, it could be, you know, in a city, in a village, could be a large school, a small school, it could be an alternative school, it could be a government school, any school that is proactively already building change makers within its institution, defining this in many different ways, and I'll get to that as well. So can we identify such schools? Can we bring them into a network, which we're calling the Ashoka Changemaker Schools Network? Highlight these stories, amplify them, and use these stories to develop a larger narrative around education and what good education is by giving touch and feel more, like examples that you can actually see and experience and, you know, understand. If we do that, and can we then, you know, influence various spaces to change demand, essentially, so that 5 years down the line, 10 years down the line, I don't know, if a parent wants to put their child into school, they're not only going to be looking at whether this child is going to get 100% in math, but if that child is going to be an empathetic person, and if the child is going to be, you know, a democratic citizen, whatever it might be. So this is our kind of end goal, right? And where we are today is that we've identified our first 7 changemaker schools in the country. So it's a global program. It started in 2012 in the US. Globally, we have about 100 changemaker schools which have been elected and supported, and we're already seeing a lot of shift in conversation around education. I'm sure some of us have been party to these kinds of conversations as well. In India, we've just elected our first 7. Naveen School Head Start Learning Center is one of them. And it's just amazing to see the diversity already in the network. We have a tribal school, we have a semi-rural school, semi-urban school, we have a large school in Bombay, large elite school in Bombay, we have an alternative elite school in Ahmedabad. So we have all kinds of schools which are already coming into the network, and we are going to be looking for more of such schools going forward. how we select them, this is where, you know, the data bit comes in, I think, because the way we look at data is a little bit different from how, you know, we've been discussing today. We collect data in through very deep conversations around life histories, journeys, and track records, essentially. So we spend a lot of time in conversation with very different people within the school, all kinds of stakeholders within the school, really. So, you know, starting from the management to children, to teachers, to parents, we spend days just talking to them about how they see the world, you know, how they see the future, and how they see education. So we're looking for alignment across, and we're also looking for examples of how these guys are building empathy on the ground, essentially. Yeah, I have 2 minutes more? All right. So this is one thing that we're doing. This is one kind of way we are using to collect data. It's very interesting. It's very deep. It's not very quantitative, to be honest. It's fairly experiential. But I think that's where the beauty of this entire process is. That's the first thing. The second kind of thing that we're doing right now is we're developing a rubric. And this is to be able to help anyone, be it a parent, a teacher, anyone who works with children, to assess if their kids are developing these skills at all. So we're coming up with observable indicators for empathy, for teamwork, for leadership, for creativity, all kind of going in with each other. We're developing these indicators, and then we're gonna be creating some kind of open source way which everyone can use to assess their own kids. So that's something that we're doing. I think that's where our kind of engagement with data has been. It's, like I said, it's fairly new, it's fairly recent, we're still learning. So it'd be great to hear some ideas and thoughts from you on how we can look at this differently, look at this more sustainably, look at this, in very different ways. Right now, or questions right now or later?
No.
Later, so park your questions and we'll talk about it in a little bit.